The 12 months of Trump mass, January. Last year, most conservatives got their biggest Christmas gift very, very early, namely, on November 8. That's when Donald Trump became the president-elect in one of the most stunning upsets in American political history. Well, not if you ask him, but still. However, that was the frustrating part. We had to wait until January 20 to unwrap it. Once we did, however, a quick-moving year full of conservative white goodness lay ahead, replete with liberal tears and snowflake melting. And much to everyone's surprise, it's been an incredibly productive year for the president. I say surprising because if you listen to the media, all that's happened so far is that Trump tweets a lot and gets into fights with late-night hosts. Yes, there have been ups and there have been downs, but it's been an incredibly fruitful 2017 for the new president. As the year comes to a close and we gather round the hearth to celebrate the fact that Hillary Clinton is on a world tour for a horrible book as opposed to a diplomatic tour for a horrible foreign policy, we're going to take a little time to celebrate the 12 months of Trump mass. We'll unwrap these gifts seriatim, starting with the inaugural month of January. It may have been short, but it may have been sweet. First, take another look at the inaugural speech. You don't have to watch all of it, of course, but it wouldn't hurt anyone if you did, and it's so freaked out liberals used to boilerplate pablum that its straightforwardness is worth another look. Then, he got down to work. Putting that pen and phone to good use, whenever he couldn't get things by the legislature, Barack Obama used to brag that he had a pen and a phone to set things right. Well, that which can be done with the pen and the phone can also be undone with the pen and the phone, and Donald Trump certainly proved that in the first 72 hours of his presidency. Almost as soon as he was ensconced in the Oval Office, he signed four major executive orders. One killed the Trans-Pacific Partnership, a free trade agreement many on both the left and right found problematic. Then, he instituted a federal hiring freeze for all agencies except for the military in order to save money. He also reinstated the Mexico City policy, which withheld federal funding from organizations that perform or promote abortions in the course of international aid work. Finally, he directed agencies to waive, defer, grant exemptions from, or delay the implementation of any provision or requirement of Obamacare which would place a fiscal burden on any state or a cost, fee, tax, penalty, or regulatory burden on individuals, families, health care providers, health insurers, patients, recipients of health care services, purchasers of health insurance, or makers of medical devices, products, or medications. Now that's how you use a pen and phone. Supporting the March for Life, every January, hundreds of thousands of people attend the March for Life in Washington, D.C. protesting the flawed Roe v. Wade decision and the culture of murder that it's engendered. And every January, the media ignores it. Not this time, though. That's because the administration made sure the American people, and pro-life demonstrators, knew that the march had their full support. Not only did Trump announce that the marchers had his full support, Vice President Mike Pence became the first sitting VP to address and participate in the march. White House advisor Kellyanne Conway was present, too. That's a far bigger commitment than either of the last two Republican presidents, who may have championed the march but stayed away from that kind of involvement. Expediting deportation of bad hombres, as we've learned over the past year, President Trump's immigration talk was far from just talk. And he proved that as soon as he got into the Oval Office. In late January, President Trump issued an executive order both emphasizing his administration's commitment to enforcing immigration laws but clarifying what classes of individuals in this country illegally they intended to expedite deportation of. These included those who have been convicted of any criminal offense, have been charged with any criminal offense, where such charge has not been resolved, have committed acts that constitute a chargeable criminal offense, have engaged in fraud or willful misrepresentation in connection with any official matter or application before a governmental agency, or have abused any program related to receipt of public benefits, among others. Just 5 days after Obama left office. Not bad at all. Instituted the first version of the travel ban, all right, so it may have been struck down by the courts. But the Trump administration didn't stop trying, and they made it clear that stopping terrorism was a priority yet again. And, as we've seen so many times over the past 12 months, that's a very big deal. Cut those regulations. Obama's aforementioned pen and phone were busy little creatures, especially in the area of creating new regulations. As with most bureaucrats, the former president probably thought that cutting those regulations would take so much time that they would stay on the books. President Trump had an ingenious way to counter this. He signed an executive order mandating that for every one new regulation, two must be cut. If you have a regulation you want, number one, we're not going to approve it because it's already been approved probably in 17 different forms, Trump said, according to Politico. But if we do, the only way you have a chance is we have to knock out two regulations for every new regulation. So if there's a new regulation, they have to knock out two. As you'll see later on in the 12 months of Trump-mas, they did a little better than that. Other stalking stuffers from January, Trump resumed criminal prosecution of individuals who had illegally crossed the border for the first time, expedited environmental reviews on infrastructure projects and reduced regulatory burdens on manufacturers, introduced series of new task forces designed to eliminate job-killing regulations, and announced he was donating his entire salary. In other words, January was a pretty good month for conservatives. And yet, the Donald was just getting warmed up.